So the first step is that who, right? If you can't be account-based if you don't have a list of named accounts.
Hello, Sales Nation. I'm Will Barron, host of the Salesman Podcast. Welcome to today's show. On today's show, we have Jon Miller, and he is the CEO of Engageo. And on today's show, we're diving into how we can get started as a B2B sales rep, as an individual contributor to your company, how you can get started with account-based sales development. You can find out more about Jon over at engageo.com. And with all that said, let's jump into today's show. Hey, Jon, and welcome to the Salesman Podcast.
Thank you. Howdy.
I'm glad to have you on, mate. I'm glad to dive into this topic with you today because it's something that we've covered on other shows, and I think you're going to have some real insights as to how we can perhaps even practically put some of this into place as opposed to talking about all the theory of things. So I'm going to ask you a very purposefully and consciously a very open-ended question here, and that is, for salespeople who would like to experiment with account-based sales development or account-based selling, what should be the first step, or what would be your first step if you were thinking about experiments with some of this as well?
Yeah, well, sure. So, you know, the super highest level, an account-based process, I think just follows three basic ideas. Number one, the who. Which accounts do I want to go after and which people at those accounts? Number two, the what. What can I say to the people at those accounts that's going to be relevant and actually make them engage? And then number three, the where, which is, all right, now let me actually go reach out and try to interact and engage with these accounts. So the first step is that who, right? If you can't be account-based if you don't have a list of named accounts, you know, and so it's pretty straightforward, you know, and there's a lot more we could talk about kind of how many accounts and how do you prioritize them. But that's the first piece is, you know, pick your target accounts.
Well, let's stop on this, Jon, and then we'll dive through the others later on in the show, because this is clearly, I think a lot of people get this wrong. A lot of people have misconceptions about what it all means. And I've talked to salespeople who have tried to implement an account-based selling model. They'll come up with a list of accounts. And then within a week or two, the next email they give me is they're back to just selling to individuals and they've forgotten the account side of things.
Yep.
So how many accounts, you kind of listed them, but how many accounts should we have? How big an account is an account versus an individual? You know, how many people within the account should we be engaging with? I'm throwing a lot at you here, but I just want to get what's the top two or three things that we should be focusing on first?
Okay, sure. Well, let's first by just saying kind of, what are we selling, right? Because that's probably the first piece you got to get, you know, figure out. In general, I'd say your account-based strategies, you know, that's for going after the big fish, you know, where you need a spear and not a net to catch them. And so, you know, as a rule of thumb, I tend to say $25,000 of average contract value and up, you know, is sort of when you want to start even thinking about using these kind of account-based approaches. Now, if you get up to $100,000 and up, now you're definitely going after the bigger fish and you definitely want to be in the account-based world. And at $1 million and up, you're probably definitely already there. So I think that's kind of, you know, the first piece. You know, I recommend that people think about three styles of being account-based that depends ultimately on the size of the deal, you know, and roughly the bigger the deal, the more you're going to be able to put into being more relevant and more effective, you know, to that account. So at the top of the pyramid, for the really big, complicated, high value deals, you know, let's just call that kind of your classic account-based approach. And what I mean by classic, it's you're treating each account as a market of one. You know, just like if you were going to enter Germany, you'd put together a country plan for how to enter Germany. You know, you're trying to get into GE and you're going to put together a plan for how you're going to get into GE. Right, which means researching the hell out of that account specifically, mapping the buying centers, understanding who all the people are in each of those buying centers. You read the 10K and the annual report to figure out what's going on in the business, you know, and you take all that insight and you use it to create completely customized activities.
And let me just stop you here a sec because I don't want to gloss over this. Is this I just really want to clarify, and again, I want to get real practical for the audience. Is this a physical, like, you know, whether it's on computer or paper, but a series of documents, a actual plan that has play by play, that has some kind of timeline? Is that the detail that we're going into this? Because again, some of the audience will listen to what you said and go, I've read all that stuff, you know, last year. I know it all off the top of my head, whereas clearly it changes over time. Is this something that should be documented? So there's a strategy behind all of this.
100%. Right. I mean, you know, it's probably a 20, 30 page thing, you know, before it's really complete. And here's the thing, and we should get into this later in the talk. An account-based strategy is a team-based strategy, right? By definition, you want to be using all the resources of your company, right? Don't be the individual lone salesperson trying to penetrate this big global account, right? You're going to be using your boss and the rest of the sales executives. You're going to be using your sales development team. You should be using marketing. And in the right ways, you should be using your executives, right? Now, how are you going to coordinate and orchestrate all those people if you don't have a documented account plan, right? So if it's just in your head, you know, you can't be doing the team-based. It's got to be a written document.
Cool.
You know, so that's for your top tier. So again, think about the GEs of the world, the big whales, the really large ones. The second level is kind of a lighter tier. And, you know, in this one, you know, you still have the list of named accounts. You're still going to, you know, identify maybe not every person in every buying center in the account, but you're going to want to at least make sure you know who are the key people and the key personas that you need to sell to. You know, so there is still some account mapping going on. And your research is definitely lighter. You know, sometimes it can be as simple as, you know, the classic three things in 3 minutes. You know, that, you know, but the goal here is still, at least when you're talking to those key personas, you want to make sure that every interaction is personalized, reviewed, and approved by a human. And then there's the bottom tier, which some people call programmatic. And it's programmatic because it can be entirely automated. You know, the first two I talked about, a human is definitely involved with personalizing every interaction. This third one, maybe you're only personalizing and customizing at the industry and the persona level and not down to kind of the human personalization. And so there, the level of research is just kind of making sure your data is right. You know, you got the industry set properly, you know, and maybe, you know, an SDR will still do three things in 3 minutes just to slightly customize an email before it goes out. But it's you know, more automated, you know, streamlined process. So you have the top tier, the middle tier, the third tier. The right number of accounts is the number of accounts that you can deliver on that level of personalization and research for, right? So, you know, if you only are doing tier three, you know, with programmatic approaches, which maybe is appropriate if you're mostly just selling 25K deals, you know, in that case, you could probably handle a few hundred, you know, of these accounts as an individual account executive, mm-hmm. you know, but if you're really going after the big, big whales, you know, and you have to create this deep reach account plan for each one. Maybe five is the right number, you know, for one account executive. You know, and obviously you can have hybrids. You know, here at Engageo, you know, our reps have one or two tier ones, about 20 tier twos, and about 100 tier threes. You know, and so we sort of, you know, we do a mix, you know, across all those. Again,
and why did you do that? Let me just ask, because I see when I speak to people who are pushing this account-based everything approach, they are very, the majority of them, very keen to have, you know, the split between SDR, BDR, and all the different names and acronyms that are all coming to the forefront of all of this. But then there seems to be a split between the approach that you are doing of perhaps the account manager and or the team that are split up between whether you've got an account manager, then an SDR, and then someone technical or whatever in that team. Some people are very focused on having the more experienced people just have one or two huge accounts that they're going after, and the smaller ones are split to other people. And then other people are doing kind of what how you just described of there's a mix and everyone's pitching into them all. Is there a methodology behind that?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, our sales team's still relatively small with six people. And so, you know, our, you know, we our reps, who I would say are mostly mid-market level reps,
okay,
you know, selling to companies between 200 and 2,000 employees, they don't want to never be able to sell a big enterprise. And so we let them have a couple of the larger accounts, you know, almost as a development, you know, technique, because you know, we haven't really built out a team of just enterprise whale hunters.
Okay.
As we get bigger, I think, you know, in any sales team, the bigger you are, the more specialized you're going to be. You know, and I think that's true kind of across the board.
Yeah. The only reason I asked is for perhaps an individual salesperson who's listening to this who wants to push the team into this approach, if it's not already going, I was just intrigued whether the payoff of going after a few big ones versus having a mix of a few or one or two big ones and some smaller ones versus perhaps the approach that they've got at the moment is more of an automated kind of spray and pray model, whether there was a methodology between which was more effective versus risk perhaps, or, and I guess it comes down to the actual company themselves and their products as well.
Yeah. You know, I mean, it's interesting, at least in software as a service, which is where I've spent the most time, people have looked at this. There does not seem to be any one price point that makes for a better company. You know, like, you know, you have very successful companies selling an average contract value of 250K, and you have very successful companies that sell an ACV of 10K, right? So I think it's less about, oh, there's one good place to be, as just making sure that, you know, wherever you are, you're applying that right level of personalization. Now, here's the thing. Like, we didn't really talk much about the value of being account-based. Like, why would you even want to do this in the first place? You know, but, you know, I personally think that, you know, sales today has become way too reliant on what I call sales spam as a prospecting technique. And I mean, you're nodding your head. I mean,
just, it's one of my bugbears. I've talked about it on the show so many times. Oh. And let me just tell you on this so that I can't just pinch your answer and use it as mine. But my thoughts on this is, if you have an individual who's capable, you know, has a bit about them, can physically write an email, customize it, can bring in their own data, that is a selling advantage over automation, for whether it be marketing automation or marketing, sales or marketing automation. Having an individual there that can do that, if that person's not being utilized, if they are just spamming out emails, I just think that's you're undervaluing the team that you've got there. So that's my like kind of bugbear of it all.
Yeah, I mean, I think it undervalues the team, but I also think it is a cliff, that you're approaching a cliff of effectiveness. I mean, just think about it. When I get these things, I mean, literally, I hit the spam button. I don't hit delete. I hit spam, which is sending a signal back to the Google and the other, you know, spam filters, that you personally are a spammer, which means more, it makes it slightly more likely that any other email you send is going to get blocked. All right. Now, you know, the marketing, like 10 years ago, our inboxes were filled with marketing spam. You know, whether it's, you know, Viagra ads or even just things that were kind of more appropriate. You know, it was a real problem, and the industry figured out how to stop it, right? Both through a combination of legal regulation and actually even more importantly, technology, right? Spam filters. And today it's pretty good, right? Our inboxes are mostly clear of marketing spam, but the sales spam has kind of risen to take its place, and the sales spam has worked because it gets around the technology, the way the spam filters work. You know, because spam filters try to let one-to-one emails through. You know, so an individual salesperson sends an email, looks like it came from an individual, it gets through. But as more and more people do what I do, which is hit the spam button, and more importantly, you know, you're naive if you don't think that the spam filters are working hard on figuring out how to stop the sales spam, you know, in general. So if your business is relying on sending automated generic templated messages as a prospecting technique, right? You're going to, I think within a year or two, find yourselves unable to reach your target customers.
I think it goes beyond technology as well, because 10 years, well, I was at uni 10 years ago, and the only real emails I got were kind of like chain mails of fill in this and, you know, sharing. And there'll be some of the audience who won't even know what I'm talking about, but there'll be a good chunk that do. And so I'd reply to every single one, and it'd be a picture or a family picture, and I'd open every email and I'd view every email. Now, and I'd feel bad if I ignored someone. Now I get, I'm sure you get way more emails than what I do, trying to sell you pictures for different things with your background as a business and that. But I get pitched quite a lot. I get a lot of emails from people that are half automated, half they've made somewhat effort to get to me. But if it's not a fully bespoke email that's given me something in value, or even just stroke my ego, all you got to say is I love the show and I'm paying attention. But if that isn't in there, I just delete it and I don't think anything of it, and I will never think to follow up. So I think there's both the technology side of things, and people are just getting more precious with the content through email that they're going to consume, aren't they?
So, I mean, ultimately, if you've gone through the time to pick a list of target accounts, right, and said, these are the accounts I care about, you've gone through the time to like understand them and do some of the mapping, like why in God's name would you risk them hitting the spam button or at least just ignoring you by sending them something generic, right? As salespeople, we've got to raise our game. We've got to find a way to increase our odds and do better to reach these important people, you know, at the important accounts. And that is creating better emails, whether they're completely bespoke, you know, or, you know, I don't think it's terrible if much of the email is the same, because much of the email is going to be the same, but it's still got to be something that's at the top that is relevant and resonant to that person, you know? And again, that can be the three things in 3 minutes.
Explain that, John.
Sorry. Okay. Yeah. That's, you know, I forget who actually came up with that. I should give them credit, but you can find a lot about a person and a company in about 3 minutes. So if you can just figure out something about their industry, i.e. do you work with any company similar to them? If you can find out something about their company, right? Maybe they just hired a new executive, or they just issued an earnings release, or they did something. And something about that person, maybe you have some interest in common, right? You know, all that takes is a quick look at their LinkedIn profile. You can spend 3 minutes and now you've got some pretty good fodder to take a generic email and turn it into something a lot more relevant.
And I want to take a step back, John, before we dive any further into these useful emails. And we'll end the show back on emails, because clearly it's a really important topic that our audience are, you know, very, very literally using every single day. And that is, we've got our accounts. You've given us some thoughts on what to look out for, how many to have, size, and then the pyramid of how important they are and how much time and effort we should put into them. Within the account themselves, how do we suss out how many people other than the clear decision maker that we need to be trying to, you know, get in front of and influence? Because again, this is, you could probably pluck a number out of the air and it would be somewhat relevant, but is there a methodology to sussing this out?
I mean, the corporate executive board is, you know, publishes a report that shows the average number of people involved in a decision by average contract value. You know, and the interesting part is above about 10K, it quickly becomes, you know, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 20 people, you know, involved in the decision. And so that's probably the single most important reason why you need to be account based. You know, because no matter if you think you're talking to the decision maker, you know, there's going to be other people in that account who are influencing the decision. Informally, formally, you know, you name it. And so, you know, I can't give you a single magic number, you know, it's 18. But the reality is it's probably more than you think. And part of that research process is the proactive effort to identify who they all are. And you can do that through a combination of data and data vendors. But also, once you have a champion, you know, you got to sit down, and part of discovery is mapping out who are all the people.
So let me just stop here, because I want to make this really step-by-step and practical. Is this a case then that we find the decision maker or someone that we can speak to and, you know, share information with, they're on board, champion as you describe them then, and then we ask them who we need to speak to, versus we look from the outside in, say we're going to choose these six people and then start account-based selling to them. Are we finding one and then working our way along the line so we're not wasting time with people that don't really matter?
No, I think it's both. I think before you're in the deal, your experience tells you that, you know, there's going to be these five personas that you always need to be talking to, right? And so you should go and find out who those people are, you know, up front, so that you can kind of be working it. Just as a sidebar, you know, kind of off that, we can come back to this later, but you know, we're running a program right now here at Engageo where we've sent a package to a bunch of our target accounts that had signed copies of both my books, you know, that were sort of meant for the kind of key person we're sending it to. But we also included six pairs of Engageo socks, you know, in the box. And each pair of socks had a person's name on it, you know, where we've identified the that person plus the other five people that we want to talk to, you know, and we basically asked, like, hey, you know, please distribute the socks to your colleagues, right? And it's just a way to get some splash effect, you know, from one mailer. You know, we're hopefully going to create five conversations about Engageo. You know, I mean, not everybody will go give the socks to people, but most people probably will. You know, it's like, hey, we got these socks in the mail. You know, from who? Oh, Engageo. Oh, Engageo, I've heard of them. You know, that kind of thing.
So I thought what you were going to say then, John, I thought you were going to say, and we've put some kind of tracking device in the socks so we can see who they go out to, and then we can target those individuals because they're clearly important to the main person.
That'd be creepy. So anyway, but that, my point is just, even before we're in the deal, we've done some work to figure out the people we want, and we've reached out to them, you know, in a clever way. Once you're in the deal and once you're in the account, that's when you use your champion to help you, like, hey, who else might be involved with this decision? You know, and you try to do some mapping there. The other thing I want to say is this is also where marketing can play a really big role. You know, many salespeople have a mindset of once I'm in the deal, marketing, you step aside. Like, I don't want you marketing to my account. Right. But, you know, to me, that is a lack of orchestration. Right. That is the salesperson asking marketing to step away because they don't have a process for actually coordinating the interactions. But if you can do something in a slightly more orchestrated, coordinated way, marketing is the ideal team to make sure you're touching all the rest of the account beyond the people that you're talking to on a one-to-one basis. You know, whether that is just buying display advertisements, so that all those other people, you know, and display advertisements targeted to that specific account, so that all those other people are seeing your brand.
And how important is this? Because this clearly, you're mentioning it, but clearly it's something that's is missed, and it's just not talked about, and we don't deal with it very well in sales. But how important is this idea of brand recognition versus, you know, a salesperson's goal of very specifically talking about how the product's going to help them? How much does brand really matter?
I personally think it's really important. You know, I think that many times in a B2B decision process, humans tend to make, I think, an emotional decision up front, and much of the buying process is back justifying the conscious or subconscious decision they made up front. And there's a lot of psychology actually to support that. And so, you know, brand is how people are making those emotional decisions up front. So if there is a strong brand in place at a company, I believe that just creates tailwinds for sales.
I know from, we talk about B2B on the show, but I know a guy who, we go back and forth regularly, and he sells Ferraris. So it's his own company, he's an entrepreneur, owns a Ferrari dealership. And everyone that comes on his page, on his website, gets cookied. This might go beyond some of the listeners from a nerd perspective, but essentially he can then track people as they go on other related sites within like the Google network, or I think Facebook might be doing it now, like external ads off Facebook. And they essentially see his brand, his logo, and his company branding, and even his face in some of the instances that he's been experimenting with, as they just go around the web. Yep. They very rarely click on it. So he's paying for the number of impressions, the number of times it pops up versus how many times it gets clicked on. And he has seen a noticeable difference in the number of people that call him back and know who he is and remember him, remember his name, and all these kind of subtle things that clearly, if someone, for someone to buy from, you've got the cliche, they've got to know, like, and trust you. And he's adamant from his experiments with selling, you know, high-end Ferrari product, that this just simple, consistent brand exposure is making a difference to his conversion rates in the dealership at later dates.
And that's an example of cookie-based retargeting, right? So they came to his website, and now he shows the ads. You can also do proactive targeting, right? So in this case, I'm talking about, you know, I'm trying to sell a deal at, you know, Philips. And, you know, 98% of the people at Philips, even 98% of the people who might influence my deal, probably have never even been to my website. But I can still buy ads that target those, that company specifically. You know, so I get the same effect that your Ferrari dealer got, but even for the people who haven't already been to my site. You know. Anyway, so my point behind all that is just around the team selling, you know, and how marketing can play a role to support the, you know, making sure you're talking to all the different personas as well as sales.
For the non-decision maker, should we, as the salesperson, and so the non-decision maker but the influencer, what should we be doing to get them on board if they are, you know, clearly not directly holding the purse strings of all of this? Is it, again, a case of branding and getting them to recognize us, know us, like us, and trust us, so when we come up in another conversation with the decision maker, they go, oh, I've heard of them, I like them? Or can we be more strategic about it than just that?
I think that it depends, you know, on the size of the deal and the company and the situation, you know, and all that. You know, brand's important, but you can do one better, right? You know, I think the real goal, the thing that we really would love to be able to do in any one of these accounts, is to have a challenger sale style conversation. You know, which means actually bringing useful, valuable, and relevant commercial insight to the conversation. You know, put another way, you know, for all these kind of other people, right? If we can actually teach them something that's going to be valuable in their jobs and that is relevant to what they do, right? That's going to do a 10x better in terms of building that preference and influence and brand than just seeing my ad is going to do.
So let me ask you this then, because to bring it back into the team kind of conversation. What do we do when we've been in sales 2-3 years? We know the industry pretty well. We are clear. We know our product. We know how it can help. We know how it's going to help the business. How do we have those higher level conversations? And clearly you can see where I'm going with this. It's like the most leading question of the whole interview. But if we've got a team around us, how do we have those higher level conversations, and how do we add kind of value to the C-suite perhaps with these challenges sale or teach them something insights?
Well, less leading than you think. I don't know if I'm going this with where you wanted. you know, I think it comes back to that research that I talked about, you know, at the beginning. Like, you've got to understand what's happening with that account in order to be able to tailor what you're bringing, you know, to the conversation. And I think where you were going with the question is, and, you know, the team can help you create, you know, those pieces, you know, those materials to support the conversation, whether that's marketing or sales enablement or your executives. You know, it's the key here, I think, is sales managers should be spending time training individual salespeople, you know, less on here's what our product does, and more on here's how you actually bring, you know, have kind of this kind of valued conversation. The reality is, as an external person, you actually have a lot to say, right? You're, as a salesperson, you're talking to dozens of other companies, right? Whereas the executive at that company spends most of their day just thinking about their one company. So the ability just to bring the insights of what you know from talking to dozens of others is actually really valuable, you know, even if you're talking to somebody at a much higher level in the organization than you. So we just need to train our salespeople how to do that more effectively.
That was super empowering, and not where I was going with it, but that's probably more useful. Where I was going with this, John, was and I've done this all the time when I was in medical device sales, in that if you're having a high-level CFO conversation, why not perhaps get your CFO, if it's the deal's big enough, to get involved within that, because clearly they can have a better conversation than what you're ever going to be able to, because you're, again, not to disempower the audience, but you're on a different track, you're on the ground floor, versus they can have that industry knowledge and that industry conversation that perhaps you're not able to at this point.
Sure. I mean, that's definitely also part of the team selling situation. Honestly, where I think it's really valuable to bring in your executives is actually as a door opener. You know, I mean, this is not surprising, but if one of my account development reps, we call our SDRs ADRs because they're account developing the account.
Okay.
If one of my ADRs writes an email for me that is then sent from my account, it gets about a 10x response rate than if they just write the email and send it from their account. You know, in the same cases, I've just approved the email. You know, but because it comes from me, it works better. You know, and so people are going to respond to emails and outreaches from people of a similar higher level much more than they will from random salesperson.
And final bit on this, and then I'm going to ask you a couple of questions to ask everyone that comes on the show, and because you just piqued my interest now. Is personal brand something that's going to become more and more important within the world of sales? Clearly, you speak, you've got books, you run a very successful company, your company's doing great at the moment, that you're a name in the industry, so your personal brand has weight behind it. Should salespeople be focusing on becoming, narrowing down, I guess, their niche as small and tiny as it can, and becoming known in their niche as an individual, as opposed to just being part of a bigger company? Is that of value right now, where we are in sales?
I think it's always valuable, but it's hard. Like, I mean, I wouldn't recommend to any salesperson to just stay in one niche, you know, because I think it's gonna inherently be hard to really become known, you know, as an individual salesperson. But I do think an individual salesperson can get good at having those challenger sale conversations, you know, which will achieve much of the same effect. You know, if they can really build enough expertise to be able to, you know, teach and tailor, you know, that's where I would say people should focus. And if you publish that information, you know, I think by putting that thought leadership out there, you will indirectly also be creating some brand effect.
And final one on this, because I'm interested in the practical side of this. Should we be spending an hour a day focusing on the industry, what's going on, the decision-making changes, different, you know, things that are going on both in the accounts and the industry as a whole, so that we are an expert within that industry? Or, you know, do we need to put an arbitrary amount of time on it like that?
Good question. I think probably I would recommend that the answer depends based on your company size. You know, and as I said earlier, the bigger you get, the more specialized you get. So, you know, if I have a reasonable, decent sized company, people are doing this. They're creating account insight teams, right? Whose job it is to, you know, track the accounts and research them and understand them and publish on a weekly basis, you know, for the sales teams, like, here's what you need to know, you know, what's happening in the industries and what's happening at that company, you know? And so if you're lucky enough to work at one of those companies as a salesperson, no, just make sure you're reading the weekly snapshots. You know, if you're at a smaller company that doesn't have those kinds of resources, then yeah, you probably should be spending some time doing that.
We'll speak about it off air in a minute. Perhaps you could introduce me to, or give me a name of one of those companies, because someone who's doing that kind of role could probably be really useful as to the best places to find this kind of information and the most targeted and useful information to pull out. So we'll talk about that off air in a minute. And because I think that'd be a good guest for the show. But with that, John, I've got a couple of questions, mate, to ask everyone that comes on the show. First one, what is one thing that you believe about sales that other people don't?
Well, you know, I think we sort of talked a little about that a minute ago around branding, actually. You know, I really do think that a company that has a good brand, that is seen as a thought leader in the space, that's seen as somebody that is teaching people the way things are going, you know, that it's, you know, that company will always be a better company to sell for than a company that doesn't have the brand, right? Because it's just a rising tide, raises all the ships, you know, puts wind at your back or whatever metaphor you want. You know, so as you're an individual salesperson thinking about your next career move, you know, I would pay a lot of attention to what is the brand of that company. How is it perceived in the market? And as a sub piece of that are the customers' advocates, because that's the other thing that drives, that kind of uplift and brand. Pay more attention to that than the specifics of the product.
Definitely. I went from one of the most prestigious companies in the medical device world to perhaps the most prestigious company especially within the world of endoscopes. Well, they basically created endoscopic surgery, the founder of the company. And it was so easy to have conversations. If you had I keep trying to not use the name of the company, but I might, you can see it on my LinkedIn profile. Karl Storz is the company. If you had that on your badge, you'd literally just be able to walk into theaters. No one would even question you being there. That's how important their brand was to them. They did loads of training as well. And they did, they was products were more expensive, but the surgeons knew that they'd be taken away on training and looked after and that kind of thing. And a lot of those deals, just to emphasize what you're saying here, John, a lot of those deals that I did, they just happened because the surgeon wanted the company as opposed to the products, because the products are quite similar in a lot of regards to the competitors. Mm-hmm. But they valued everything else that was behind it. So it made it far easier to just get in the door and 50% of the deals close themselves.
Deals that close themselves are a good thing.
Good man. Okay, next one. What is one book or resource that you'd recommend to the sales and podcast audience?
Well, I've recently become a big fan of all of the Patrick Lencioni management books. He's a consultant that kind of, wrote books like the Five Temptations of the CEO and the Four Attributes of the Highly Effective Leader or something like that. But one of his books that I recommend to everybody is called Death by Meeting. And it's a short, fun little parable, easy to read, that I think shares a lot of best practices about just how should companies run effective meetings. So it's more of a general management book than a sales book, but it's one of the ones that has really helped influence, how I think about running my company.
I've read it. I will link it in the show notes. And I think it's applicable to sales meetings as well. I think a lot of sales meetings are not orchestrated in the right way. And a lot of them aren't even needed in a lot of cases, especially field sales as well.
I will say one tip from that book that is super relevant to sales is creating drama in the meeting. Mm. How do you open the meeting up to help everybody understand, what's at stake? Because if you can do that in a way that really captures people, they're going to be much more engaged throughout the entire meeting than if there's no drama.
Definitely, definitely. And I've got one final question for you, John, and that is something I ask everyone that comes on the show. If you could go back in time and speak to your younger self, what would be the one piece of advice you'd give him to help him become better at selling?
Well, I forget when I got this advice myself, but I think it is super true. And that is, when things are good, they're never as good as they seem. And when times are bad, they're never as bad as they seem. So that has so many lessons around how you sort of think about, managing your days and managing your weeks. I think about it in terms of managing my company. So things are never as good as they seem or as bad as they seem.
Nice. Appreciate that. And with that, mate, tell us a little bit about Engaggio and where we can find out a bit more about you as well.
Sure. So, Engaggio, we are the platform for fishing with spears. We help you orchestrate your human connections at your target accounts across at scale. And more for the marketing department, we really help them to measure how all their activities are impacting, engaging the accounts at an account level. So it is that platform for account-based marketing and sales. You can track me down on Twitter. My handle is @JohnMiller. And to be honest, the best way to learn more about any of this stuff is to download either or both of my books, The Clear and Complete Guide to Account-Based Sales Development and The Clear and Complete Guide to Account-Based Marketing. You can get both on our website at engaggio.com/guide.
We'll link to all that, including the guides as well, just so it's all on one page in the show notes for this episode or at salesman.red. And with that, John, fascinating discussion, mate. I think we could probably do another 3 or 4 shows going further down the funnel of what we need to do to engage and get a commitment and all this kind of stuff that needs to happen on the account, the spread of the account, as opposed to the individual person, which is a shift in mindset, I'm sure. And with that, mate, I want to thank you for joining us on the Salesman Podcast.
Thank you.